Okay, welcome back. We are starting our last concluding panel. And the task for the concluding panel is very simple, is to aggregate all this wonderful information that we've received today and present some overview on challenges to democracy that both trade agreements represent, to speak about long arc of history in terms of the kind of developments they represent, and then to offer some ray of sunshine in this otherwise pessimistic scenario by suggesting some ways to resist some strategies that have worked previously, some failures from which we can learn. So that's a small task that the two speakers have on this panel. So as you have already heard from quite a few presenters that have touched on issue that these two trade deals represent a major challenge to democracy. And democracy in many different ways, and you could say there's sort of layered challenges ahead for global citizens. They are challenges for developing states versus strong established Western states. There are challenges in terms of various protections of human rights, protections of participation, protections of citizen voice. So many different ways that you can think democracy is being challenged by these trade agreements. So we'll just touch on it in two very specific ways. We have two speakers that both have great experience in dealing with trade deals, but in very different fora. And hopefully that conversation will give you a broader perspective of both the challenges and also our resistance past. As Amy Kupczynski already noted, this is not simply a challenge that is presented by these two trade deals. Democracy has been challenged in various ways, even domestically, because trade, as she observed, has a much easier way of getting through Congress, being sort of having less oversight, congressional, judicial, electoral, if you will, than human rights do, for example, which it's very difficult to amend the Bill of Rights, of course. The same is true in European Union. European Union, for many people, represents a kind of aspirational example of where people could come together, different, previously not very happy groups of people embracing each other's diversity and doing something together. But there is a different, darker side to European Union too. Already the competition principle enshrined in EU's various treaties is able to supersede national protections of labor, of environmental rights, of various things that have already been mentioned. So this issue is not necessarily new. So that's why we are talking about this kind of longer process of challenges perhaps that are occurring together rather than necessarily something very new. We also want to perhaps note observation made by President Van Zandt at the beginning of the conference, at the opening remarks, is that there's a tendency increasingly to describe these deals as purely technical solutions for purely technical problems. In fact, in one of the most staggering observations about European Union and its supposedly lacking democratic credentials, one of the liberal academics once pointed out that, well, it's about economics, and as everyone knows, economics is not about democracy, which for democracy scholars, it left our jaws a little bit wider open. But that is a perspective, right? That is how quite a lot of justifications are made, why we should have no oversight, why citizens have really no role in these conversations. They don't understand, they don't have the expertise. And by the way, this is not really about values. This is not about redistribution of goods. This is not about costs and benefits. This is purely about technical things. And we have experts to work on these. So that is also something that in this conference we have tried to undermine as a kind of discursive formula that's being used. So let me introduce my two panelists. Immediately to my left is Mr. Amorim. And Mr. Amorim has rather long and colorful service for his country. He has occupied important ambassadorial roles in Geneva, New York, in London. He was president of the UN Security Council and of the Conference on Disarmament. He was longest serving Brazilian foreign minister, working under President Franco and President Lula da Silva, and he was minister of defense during President Rousseff's first term as well. Foreign policy blogger in 2009 has described him as the world's best foreign minister. And in 2010, the same magazine ranked him as number 6 amongst 100 top global thinkers. And he has written several books and articles on various issues in international relations. And his latest book is Tehran, Ramallah, and Doha, Memories of an Assertive Foreign Policy. And that's what we want to hear about, this assertive foreign policy. And my other panelist is Lori Wallach. And Lori Wallach has promoted public interest regarding globalization and international commercial agreements in every fora, in Congress, in foreign parliaments, in courts, to government agencies, the media, and on the streets. And I know that she recently returned from just one such fora in Hanover, Germany, where she was together with a couple of other of our previous speakers. And they took to the streets to protest the TTIP. Thank you. She has been described as Ralph Nader with a sense of humor. So you see we have stacked the last panel with real characters, and as well as a trade debates guerrilla warrior. So we can give guerrilla warriors a positive spin today. For 20 years, Wallach has played a prominent role in the United States and internationally in roiling debate over the terms of globalization. And she's here as a founder of the Citizen Trade Campaign, a U.S. national coalition of consumers, labor, environmental, family, farm, religious, and civil rights groups representing over 11 million Americans. She has done this for several years now as a director of the agency. So please welcome our speakers. And I'll turn the microphone over to Mr. Mamorim.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure being here in the new school, very famous for its progressive debates. I'm very, really glad to be here. I want to thank Sakiko, who was the originator of the idea, and I think that has a lot to do with our own debates in this UN panel on access to medicines, which is not irrelevant to things that have been discussed before. And I also want to thank Everita because she also, as many others, had a lot of patience with my logistic arrangements. I mean, I'm an old man, so it's difficult to move. But anyway, let me try to say some of the things that have to do with what has been said before. I'm sure they have to do with democracy and with resistance. I'm not so sure that I'll be able to do anything that relates to rewriting the rules, although I was involved in some of that in the past. Well, let me first of all say something because in the latest interventions mainly, were very important one. I'm sorry that one of my sons was not here because he's much better advocate on environmental questions than I am. But I think there was one point on which I want to make a remark, and this was somehow to lump together WTO with the other trade agreements. I signed the Uruguay Round as foreign minister of Brazil, and I was involved in the launching of the Doha Round as ambassador in Geneva. And I was very active there for a long time. I don't know if that's a positive credential or a negative one, but I want to say something. If the world is not good with the WTO, at least from the point of view of Brazil or an emerging country, it would be worse without the WTO. That's what I can assure you. I mean, there would be no assurance that climate rules would be respected. There was no assurance that other labor rules would be respected because, as you have heard this morning, for instance, the most important country has not signed most of the conventions. And apart from that, countries like my own, I can only speak about my experience. I came to an age in which I don't speak on theory anymore. I only tell stories. And if there is any moral in that story, good. If there is no moral, so much the worse. But anyway, what I felt, for instance, in a country like Brazil in the 80s, I mean, it's part of my colorful biography, as you said. I was in the 70s, I was involved, early 80s, I was involved in the film industry, and later on, I was involved in science and technology. And in the two fields, that I was involved, we faced the threat of unilateral action by your country, by the United States. I'm very happy that we are a very democratic country to invite someone like myself to speak here. In the two cases, we were threatened by of unilateral action by the United States, based on the famous the Special 301 section of the trade law, because we were not conforming to what the United States expected us to do in terms of first in the film industry, because of and it was not strictly copyright. It was really the how much you pay for them and rules that established, like the Canadians do, by the way, the need for protect national production, cultural diversity, things that are also important when you discuss trade deals. In the second case, we were threatened because we are trying to develop an IT, an information technology of our own. And that, of course, implied some restrictions to in terms of trade. And in the two cases, we were threatened by unilateral action. And you know, in economy, the mere threat is already very disrupting, because people already think that, well, we'll not be able to export this and that. So that has an immediate economic and social impact. And fortunately, after the creation of WTO, which expanded on the GATT, at least this has not happened anymore. There was no case, at least against Brazil, and I suppose not many anyway, of direct unilateral action against a poorer country, as it happened in before. So it's not all negative about the WTO, and I don't think it can be lumped together with other trade agreements, some of which actually deserve resistance. I'll just mention three. I tried to make as short as possible three instances in which we were involved in resistance. And resistance has to do not only with the democracy inside the countries, this is a very important point that we're living now in Brazil, by the way, but I won't comment on that, but democracy also has to do with how countries relate to each other and how they follow rules. And I think the fact that you have a set of rules, including for settling disputes in the WTO, is some kind of protection. Since the WTO was created, we won some cases, we lost others, but most I would say we won, and just because we were trying to apply the correct rules. I mean, we won cases on cotton against the United States, on sugar against the European Union, in both cases because of subsidies, and we were, let us say, on an even basis with Canada on airplanes, which very important that the developing country could invoke the WTO to defend its right to produce airplanes. This has to be taken into account. Of course, it has many defects. I could make an enormous list of the unfair treatment that countries have suffered, of the inadequacy of the environmental rules, the lack of rules for labor, and all that. I mean, there is an enormous, but I think the world without the WTO would not necessarily be better. That's the only point that I would like to make, and I think it's a bit confusing to put everything together. Let me speak about the so-called TRIPS flexibilities, because this is, I think, the reason why Sakiku first invited me, because just by chance, I was very much involved in the negotiation of TRIPS, first in the Uruguay round as ambassador and director for economic affairs, and later on, again in Geneva, as ambassador when the Doha Declaration was adopted. And I think this is very interesting to see, because actually, when the TRIPS agreement was made part of the whole Uruguay round, we considered countries like Brazil, a big defeat. We were defeated. We didn't want TRIPS to exist, by the way. If it would exist, it should be limited to counter trade in counterfeited goods or things like that. But the pressure of the developed countries, not only the United States and other ones, was enormous. So in the end, we had to accept, because we had other vulnerabilities. A country like Brazil, for instance, was very dependent on loans by the IMF. And people would say, people in very high positions, they would phone other people in high positions in my country or in other countries, say, well, if you don't change your position in relation to the negotiation of intellectual property, forget about the next IMF loan. And we could not live without the next IMF loan, short of a revolution. So I think nowadays the situation has changed a little bit, fortunately for countries like Brazil, but still it's a very difficult situation. So we were forced to accept an agreement on TRIPS. We did whatever we could to avoid an interconnection between the agreements, but in the end, even that battle, we lost. We lost. So the TRIPS agreement is part of the whole, what they call the single undertaking. And that meant, just to, in a very short way of describing it, that if you committed a violation in intellectual property, another country, the US, the European Union, could sanction, retaliate Brazil on orange juice or steel, to speak about something that has always been a problem in our relations, or whatever. So it put us in a very vulnerable position. What we managed to get then, and that's a kind of a parenthesis, but it's an interesting one to see how negotiations exist and make resistance possible. We said, well, if cross retaliation, that's the name that they gave to it, can happen from intellectual property to goods, or from services, which was another important item, to goods, why can't we make the other way around also? And it's very interesting that the two cases that have happened so far, one involving Ecuador and the European Union, was on the other direction. In other words, because of course why this is so important for developing countries? Because if you have a violation, in their case was bananas. I mean, how can they retaliate the European Union on the area of goods? Impossible, because everything that they buy, it's absolutely essential for them. They cannot fail buying the equipment that they need for their own development. So they got the right to retaliate in intellectual property. And some years later, Brazil also, in the question against the United States, got the right to retaliate on intellectual property. And it was the only thing that made the Americans, and in the other case, the Europeans, budge. Because, of course, they knew that we didn't have power in the area of goods or even services. But in the area of intellectual property, that was something that really might hurt. And in the two cases, it somehow worked. I mean, that doesn't work perfectly, but anyway, it somehow worked that we got even some indemnity in the case of the cotton in the United States, and part of this indemnity is used for technical cooperation in the cotton production in Africa, which are also interested, but the case was only Brazil. Well, let me say, so the TRIPS agreement in itself was, we considered, very bad, and I remember discussing with one of my advisors who was there, I see Brazilian diplomats there, ambassador, now he's an ambassador, then he was a counselor, Peter Gibbon, and he was very disappointed, more than I was. And I said, no, but there are some ambiguities. Nobody spoke of flexibility. The word flexibility doesn't appear, as far as I can remember, in the TRIPS agreement. But there were some things that were ambiguous. I mean, there was the provision of compulsory license, but it was made so difficult that no one thought that one could use it. And in reality, that was the situation that lasted somehow until the Doha Declaration. And what happened in the meantime? And that's important for democracy, because I think there was a sort of alliance between the position of some countries like Brazil and representatives of the civil society. And this was caused, of course, by a tragedy, an enormous tragedy, which was the HIV/AIDS epidemics. Brazil, as many other countries, developing countries, had a big epidemics of HIV/AIDS, and we thought, well, if we're going to pay the fabulous amounts that were charged by the medicament. Well, the people could not buy, of course, and the government could not have the program. So we had a very important program in generic products, and the United States tried to have a case against Brazil, but it gave up. It gave up for two basic reasons. First, because we discovered that the United States patent law also has provisions of protection of national production. So, and we say, well, okay, we'll open a case against you on that case as well. We are always a little bit, more bolder than our own strength, maybe, but that worked. And the other was already because at that point, this big community all over the world, the problems in Africa and so on, that was suffering from HIV/AIDS, were on our side. And that's an interesting thing that for negotiators, I don't know how many negotiators you have here, that's important because, you know, these things normally are, as people have said before, discussed in a very intransparent way. And I remember when we were preparing the Doha declaration, the Doha agreement, the chairman of the WTO council was said, well, because he had the previous experience of Seattle, which was very bad from the WTO point of view in many respects. And one of the reasons was that because the document had many alternatives, brackets, and so on. I said, no, I want to present a clean text to the ministers. I was ambassador at the time, to the ministers. And I had to tell him, so no alternatives, no brackets. I said, at that point, there were two formulations for the paragraph on trips and health, one by developing countries, in which we had a lot of participation. Of course, I would say without any modesty that Brazil somehow led the process because we had the concrete problem that we were living. And there was one by developed countries. And no wonder they were very different. I mean, and in fact, what did we do? We tried to transform the ambiguities into flexibilities by legitimizing them. So what we tried to say, then it was said in a slightly different way, but we were trying to say was nothing the TRIPS agreement can prevent countries from doing what they have to do in terms of public health, in summary, without specifying any kind of disease or any emergency or crisis. This is very important. So I told the chairman, if you want to present a clean text, fine. Please tell me when I'm too long. 5 minutes? No, a little more. So if you want to present a clean text, fine. But in the case of TRIPS and health, don't dare to arbitrate. And why did I say that? If you cannot opt for the developing countries formula, put a 2. Let it go to the ministers. Why? Because I know that in Doha, it would be a political environment. NGOs would be there, ministers would be there, preoccupied with other bigger questions. 9/11 had just happened, and the United States, until today, I believe that Doha was launched because of 9/11, really. And the United States was very much needing, not the whole world, but the United States as a leader, was needing good news in the economic sphere. So the interesting thing is that, in theory, the most difficult chapter, as everybody who was in the media and followed that know, was the TRIPS and health. And it was the first to be solved. And when it was solved, it was a kind of a gateway for other issues as well, and the Doha Declaration came. So, and the Doha Declaration, this is very important to say, because now I see, even when I, in this panel of the UN, reading the background papers, they say, well, the Doha Declaration is basically about HIV/AIDS. No. The Doha Declaration, it's about any problem, any public health problem. And it gives the countries the possibility, as someone underlined today in this morning, to resort to compulsory licenses for any, in any case in which they need to have a cheaper medicament. Of course, this doesn't mean that the countries have always used. Many people speak, oh, countries don't use the flexibilities. We heard that a lot in the panel. Well, and many people speak, well, nowadays you have voluntary licensing, differentiated pricing. But if you didn't have the possibility of compulsory license, that would never happen. Even Brazil, who actually started the question, we used very rarely, because the mere possibility of using led the laboratories to negotiate prices with us. We only used, I believe, really on one case, efavirenz, which is a drug for cancer. I don't know if it's for cancer or for HIV/AIDS now. But anyway, it's the only, we used that. And it's curious enough, because it's very curious, because we used that in a case that was not foreseen in the original Doha Declaration, because there was a small extension in 2003, mainly because of the African countries and other countries which didn't have productive capacity, which extended the possibility of compulsory license to export and import. So that makes it possible for other countries to do. Well, Brazil could do it because Brazil was no longer so dependent on the IMF, and because Brazil, even if it's poor, vulnerable, and whatsoever, but it's still a big country. But when people speak about the smaller countries not using these flexibilities, well, they don't have the power. And the problem is that the Doha Declaration, of course, it protects you from retaliation in the trade field, but it doesn't protect you from pressures. I mean, oh, you know, that loan for the airport, forget about it, or you know, that other advantage that you wanted, or disagreement that you wish to make, and transfer. So the countries have these limitations. So this was a big battle, and that's why one of the main reasons why I share with everybody that spoke here the will to one of the reasons why I share the will to resist these new agreements, because they are all TRIPS plus, but they say it's very beautiful as it said TRIPS plus, but what, it's not TRIPS plus, it's TRIPS minus from the point of view of developing countries, from the point of view of people who are more interested in public health than in profit alone. So that's a very important aspect. There are other aspects also that from my point of view, these agreements are bad. One of them, I mentioned them in some of the questions that I put, but I mean one of them, and I now move to another aspect of resistance, if you wish, is the fragmentation of world trade and the fragmentation of the trading system. I think this is very bad, not only for trade and not only for developing countries, this is bad for peace. I mean, after all, the whole architecture that was taught just after the Second World War, including the United Nations, including reinforcing of ILO, UNESCO, and so on, and the World Bank, and whatever, maybe they were distorted, but the whole thing was meant to reinforce world trade as a means of peace. And I tell you, trade is not always bad. Trade, I mean, in the case of European Union, it has been an instrument, sometimes internal instrument. When, for instance, in Brazil, when we discuss in South America and discuss Mercosul, I don't know if some of you have heard of Mercosul, it's the small compared to European Union is nothing, but anyway, it's the agreement between some countries in South America. And when I hear, for instance, some Brazilian media voicing the concerns maybe of one or another sector of Brazilian industry saying, well, Mercosul is holding us back, we have to change and so on. Mercosul is not about selling another fridge or another cook or whatever. Mercosul is about peace in our region, basically. And that's why it has to be reinforced. The idea of a customs union has to be there. And I think agreements like the TPP, because they have inroads in our region, they make also more difficult to have an integration in South America. And I'm sure that people spoke about strategic motivations. I'm sure that someone who deals with strategy has also thought about this question. It's not only Sinophobia in Asia that leads to TPP, but it's also, well, I mean, this, you know, we created the first South American organization in 200 years of independence 5 or 6 years ago with the Defense Council. That doesn't please some strategists. I think they are wrong, because actually Brazil has more, let us say, Brazil and other South American countries, we have more things in common with the United States than things that separate us. But we want to be, to do our own way, to be independent, not to have to say yes, sir, all the time. I just want one moment to finish. So this is again another aspect. And then finally, if I could say, an attempt was made in our continent to have a free trade area of the Americas. And why we opposed it, and why we even tried to negotiate, but when we got the negotiation to a certain stage, the United States even gave up. But why did we oppose it? Because it had the TRIPS Plus clause. The cases on dispute settlement would not go to the WTO, would go in priority to the dispute settlement in the region, where the balance of power is, of course, much against Brazil. It had rules on government procurement, which would prevent any kind of industrial policy. In the United States, you don't need that, because you have the Pentagon. The Pentagon buys 50%. The Pentagon buys 50% of the science and technology in this country. So in Brazil doesn't have the Pentagon or the Hexagon or whatever. So we need to have a state making Brazil and Argentina. I'm speaking more of Brazil because I know a little more about Brazil. Don't know much, but I don't know a little more. Every day I think I know less, actually. But but anyway, so government procurement, services, changing rules. There is something which is very complex, I may explain, which is called in the WTO, we have an agreement which is based on positive lists. That means that what is not in the list is not subject to liberalization. What they wanted in the FTA, and it's all these agreements, because it's not only TRIPS Plus, they are TRIMS Plus, they are Services Plus, and everything, is that they wish to change to negative lists. So whatever is not excluded would be included. So even maybe something new, which didn't exist before, is automatically included in the agreement. So it's impossible to have what people used to call policy space in this situation, and many other aspects, which I think I don't want to bore you besides what I have already done. But anyway, I think it's very important, because, and I feel actually flattered, because most of the discussion here today was from the point of view of the Americans, of the North Americans, which is right. But I think you should make an effort also to see from the point of view of other countries. And that's the point of view that I humbly try to express. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I want to thank the student organizers for putting this on, the New School for sponsoring it, and the foundations for making it possible. Thank you for inviting me. And I want to recognize the honor of speaking next to Celso Amorim, but for whom the WTO would be a much worse place, given you managed to keep out some of the really worrisome things that are now being pushed in TPP and TTIP, like investor state, et cetera, that there was an agenda to put right into the WTO and impose worldwide. So it's an honor. The last panel is three major topics. Rewriting the rules, which begs the question of, all right, what else? Democracy, which gets to some structural issues and some scope issues of what is the appropriate set of issues to be covered in trade agreements, and resistance. So taking each in order, rewriting. I think the most important thing just to start out with is to reemphasize something Celeste said this morning. The rules in NAFTA, in the WTO even, throwing in all the intellectual property rules, in the proposals of TPP and TTIP, these are not acts of God. Moses did not come down with a tablet called NAFTA. Similarly, this is not like the moon's pull on the tides, an act of nature. This is just one version of rules written by those who had an ability to call the tune. And, you know, to just replicate Jared's reference to revulsion about agreeing anything that Donald Trump would say. However, it is the case when he says that different negotiators would get different rules. I don't think it's just a matter of having smarter negotiators, but it is a matter of what priorities get set, a very political question. The US in its TPP and TTIP negotiations has actually gotten to a place where they will walk out of the room if they do not get what they want on intellectual property, for instance. But they are not doing a I will walk out of the room moment for not getting labor rights or human rights or any particular interest even of US industry currency manipulation standards. Their priorities on who is at the table to decide what the priorities where we use the leverage of the US economy mean one set of rules end up being represented. And, you know, it begs a question, what else? Because part of the psychology of those who support, who've had the privileged role to set this set of rules, part of their psychology is, Tina, there is no alternative. If you are not for TPP, clearly you are for autarky or Smoot-Hawley. It's either autarky or Smoot-Hawley. You're either a protectionist or you are someone who wants no trade rules, because if you don't like TPP, there is nothing else. This is all psych ops. This is part of their PR campaign. In fact, their rules are one set of rules, and they are a set of rules that would be damaging for most of the people who would be living under them. There are numerous alternative ways to go about writing international commercial rules. In fact, instead of Tina, it is Tata. There are thousands of alternatives. Mm-hmm. It is not a policy failure. It is a political failure, which is why the resistance part is so important. I want, as a concrete example, just offer up one of many alternatives, actually two. In the WTO, the developing countries came up with, as an alternative to the continual expand the scope of the WTO, add an ISDS, et cetera, what was called the implementation agenda. It was very concrete, 115 specific items of things that needed to be done to the WTO's existing rules from the Uruguay round to make them more fair. And a lot of it was whacking back the things that were overreaches in intellectual property, et cetera. That was one alternative agenda. That is not what became the core of the Doha round. So that people like Celso Amorim had to fight to get the expansion into procurement, expansion into investment rules, et cetera, taken out. Similarly, domestic alternative, the Trade Reform Accountability Development and Employment Act. Yes, it sums up to trade. The Trade Act of 2009. You can Google it. It is 90 pages of specific rules about what should and should not be in every US trade agreement. It is not nice, fuzzy language. It is written as the negotiating objectives of a replacement to the fast-track trade negotiating system of a new kind of trade authority. So a new trade authority that's more open and accountable and new substantive provisions. It is not fuzzy. It is not a speech. It is actually how you would do it. This is just one version, but it did get over 150 congressional co-sponsors, as well as scores of US civil society organizations from the mighty AFL-CIO, a federation of all of our labor unions, but for a few, and the ones outside supported it too, to the Farmers Union, to the NAACP, to most of the country's environmental groups, you name it, all of these organizations got together and basically fought it out. What would we be for? And that's what that bill was. So out there is the alternatives. The gist of it is to roll back the things that should never be in a trade agreement, and to fix the actual trade part. So Jared said we probably aren't going to see any more FTAs, FTA moratorium, from his mouth to God's ears. So hopefully what we're talking about, say, in the Trade Act agenda, is going back and fixing the old agreements, because that's been repeated several times. Kevin said that. It's not just making sure we don't do more damage, but we have to fix the existing agreements. But these are political issues. So that gets the second part, which is democracy. So I want to just step back a second and say Public Citizen, one of the country's biggest consumer organizations, founded by Ralph Nader, who does have a sense of humor, we didn't get into the trade issue. Rather, the trade issue got into our business, which is democratic open governance. You know, we're the ones who push for the Freedom of Information Act, the Citizen Access under the Administrative Procedure Act. Good process makes good policy. That's where Nader started. And all the public interest safeguards that good process delivers. The Clean Air Act, food safety rules, et cetera. And what we realized was, we really came to recognize that the trade agreements were becoming a vehicle to serve, it was an intentional shift to use the trade negotiations. And this started in the transformation of the GATT, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, to the WTO. The GATT only covered traditional trade matters. So trading goods, if you couldn't drop it on your foot, not covered by the GATT. So this did not have intellectual property, services, investment, etc. And what we basically see is you have US industries, first agribusiness, and also the pharmaceutical industry, who realize in the context of, say, the neoliberal agenda of Reagan in Europe, Thatcher, their counterparts, thinking, boy, all these things these guys want to do are totally stuck in our democratic domestic bodies. Where's there a place we can continue to push this stuff? And they basically hijacked what was another round of GATT negotiations, the Uruguay round. No one paid attention. It was like, these were negotiations everyone thought about tariffs on underwear. Who could pay attention to this? But in fact, the whole extra agenda, intellectual property, services, all this deregulatory stuff, all these new corporate rights agenda, we're finding this new place that either A, no one paid attention to, but B, structurally, in a way was insulated from transparency and oversight. And when you think of the 1988 US-Canada agreement or the 1993 NAFTA, these were basically just because the WTO discussions were stuck, so that agenda came first regionally. But the place it really started happening was in basically hijacking the global free trade rules or the global trade rules of GATT. And basically, we ended up with a sort of neoliberal end run, so that we had first the pharmaceutical and food companies, but then, you know, 1997, there's a financial services agreement at the WTO where Wall Street goes, ooh, those guys had a really good idea. I mean, talk about FOIA discoveries. We pulled out the memo where basically then Treasury Secretary Summers is talking about the success that he had in making sure that Glass-Steagall would be committed as something we get rid of in our WTO commitments on financial services. So that we've basically locked in the loss of that policy space. So what ended up happening, basically, if you think about how the hell did this come to pass, is a little bit of a story that I experienced when I was really naive as beginning to campaign in WTO as a food safety expert. And I had a leaked copy of the WTO food text. I didn't understand the power dynamic. So I went to the various US agencies that should be paying attention to this to say, you have to go to this trade agency. Those are the ones who are doing this. So I went from FDA and USDA over to the trade agency. And they said, yeah, we'd like to help you, but actually where those rules are written is in Geneva. So then I went to Geneva. And I went to the people who are heading the talks in sanitary and phytosanitary and technical barriers to trade standards. And they said, oh, love to help you. But actually, those decisions are back home. And it became like trying to punch a marshmallow. Boom. There was no there. You couldn't actually find the place to be able to fix what in this leaked text looked like a huge rollback of our food safety standards. Why? How? A horrific mismatch between a process that was designed, fast-track trade authority, a delegation of constitutional trade authority, Article 1.8, Congress's trade authority, a delegation of that, which was supposed to be about tariffs and quotas, to suddenly negotiations on this huge scope of non-trade issues. Congress did not intend to delegate away all of Article 1. That would be the law-writing function of Congress. They meant to delegate away the tariff scope. But actually having the fast-track delegation attached to negotiations that were so much broader, and the advisory, corporate advisory system we've heard out over and over, that's in the fast-track statute, Fast-Track Act 1974, developed that corporate advisory system, which we've sued on over and over, trying to get balanced, not fixable short of a statutory change. That whole regime being applied to a much broader scope of issues led to what is exhibit one of industry capture. Via bad process gets very, very bad outcomes. Not only the writing of rules and sort of a Trojan horse delivery mechanism of policies that couldn't make it in the sunshine of our domestic agencies or domestic state legislatures or Congress, getting put into place via trade negotiations. To me, the most startling one, we consumer groups for 30 years beat pharma's attempts to extend the US patent length. We had a 17-year patent monopoly for pharmaceuticals forever. We beat them every 2 years in Congress. Congress ended, we won. The Uruguay round extended it to 20 years. Every country shall ensure conformity of all domestic laws, regulations, and administrative procedures to the WTO's agreements. Overnight, we have a 20-year patent monopoly. That change alone, according to the University of Minnesota School of Pharmacology, increased U.S. medicine prices by $20 billion just for the drugs then under patent. Overnight, sneak attack, backdoor, basically change of law, then in democracy we had won over and over. So these trade agreements not just impose these non-trade issues, but they lock into place the rules. Unlike domestic laws, where you either can go to the court to get it thrown out, you do a campaign and change it in Congress, this is like cement drying. This is super glue. Absent consensus by all countries, you can't change the rules. And this gets to the structural democracy issue and the scope question of what issues it is appropriate to set policy in the context of an international commercial agreement that locks into place policies in areas where there is changing knowledge, there are changing developments, a financial crisis, the climate crisis. You need different kinds of policy space. You have different levels of literally scientific and other knowledge that can help inform decisions. But also, you have democracy. You, under these rules, can change a government, can have a damn social revolution. And you can't change the policies unless you're willing to get hit by trade sanctions for doing it, or you can negotiate to compensate your way out. Because it locks into place the rules at the time that the agreement is made, which makes this set of negotiations on just that argument not the right place to be setting very detailed policies on a lot of environmental, social, and other issues. But then add to that the undue influence of one set of interests, commercial interests, and the issue that was raised in a previous panel by Carol Muffett about the structural issue in government. The United States trade representative is not where I want my access to medicine, food safety, or frankly, any other policy decided. This place has a revolving door, the velocity that could suck an elephant into their lobby. They go from industry to government to industry, and their idea of their constituencies are these industries. They are only thinking of exporting. They never think about the fact we're not just going to be the plaintiff in these cases. We can be the defendant, and they are the agency that coordinates all the other U.S. interests, the Environmental Protection Agency, the Food Drug, the FDA, et cetera. The other agencies that should be paying attention to these other goals are under USTR in this context and under USTR's advisors. So, as we heard earlier, think about TPP. Only 6 chapters of the 30 have to do with trade. We've got a chapter that is classic rent-seeking behavior, intellectual property monopolies in a free trade agreement. This, as well as the notion of the investor state regime, which, if you think about it, is a subsidy. It's not free trade. We all are worried about the fact that we're going to see laws attacked. But think about it from, say, what the Cato Institute says when they oppose investor state. It's a subsidy on offshoring. It's lowering the risk premium of relocating investment offshore to socialize the costs of investing in places because you've just don't have to use the domestic courts, have a guaranteed standard of treatment, et cetera, get compensation for government actions that the local companies can't possibly see compensation for. You're preferenced if you split. It's a subsidy for leaving. And so between the subsidies and the protectionism in the agreements, the fact that they use these rules under the name of free trade, and then I'm getting to the resistance part, is part of the campaigning challenge. Because what we have, in effect, is an enforceable system of global governance that officially prioritizes the interests and the power of one set of interests, commercial interests, over civil society, the people living with the results, as in, and nation states. And that is a political choice. So how strongly enforceable are these rules? We think of multilateral environmental agreements, the ILO rules, and we wish they were more enforceable. These human rules. And it is true that the WTO stopped the unilateralism. The case that did actually was Japan. going after Section 301 over Kodak film. That was the end of unilateralism. And if you want to read all these WTO cases and what they did, our website, tradewatch.org, has summaries. But the problem is we have very strongly enforced rules that act as a ceiling on progress in most instances, where the human rules have a ceiling on them versus the corporate rules, like intellectual property, have a floor every country has to meet. But if you don't have high enough intellectual property rules under these rules, it's a violation. But if you have too strong food safety, environmental, labor, other rules, that's a violation. And so just, you know, for making it concrete about how this actually works, everyone can go to the grocery store and try and find out where their beef or pork is from. You notice the label's gone? That was a WTO ruling. We're not allowed to have country of origin labeling anymore. We faced $1 billion in trade sanctions if we didn't get rid of a law that we had passed by Congress after a 20-year fight with the consumer groups against the meat industry. We won. It got through court. The meat industry tried to challenge it. And now it's gone because of the WTO. So what are some of these frames we need to debunk as part of the resistance? One is the brand of free trade. Polling shows Americans like the concept of free trade. So call this free trade agreement, and then it's easier to pass this other set of retrograde agendas. To pretend that these are just logical, technical decisions that any smart person would agree to. This is the whole frame of TTIP. We're trying to get rid of redundant regulations. We're trying to harmonize. We're trying to get efficiencies. As if it is not a highly political decision to decide where regulatory standards are going to fall and who gets to decide where they are. Is it the producers or the eaters who get to decide if they're GMO standards or not? And then, now that the economic arguments have failed, they're going to the geopolitics. And this is the NATO argument. This is the national, TPP is our ring against China. Which, of course, whoever raised the point that, yes, we have for 4 years been negotiating a bilateral investment agreement with China. The notion that TPP is to ring-fence China, but actually, under the radar, we are negotiating with China sort of messes up the TPP ring-fencing argument. But the reason you use that is because all the other arguments are not working, and China is scary. So it's squirrel. Don't look at the job loss. Oh, my God, it's China. So all of those things are the arguments that we're trying to fight against, which gets to the resistance. So the when we think about what has been effective resistance, Sonia pointed out the success stories, stopping the MAI. We heard about the FTA going down. That was largely Brazil and some other countries doing. There are a variety of other FTAs. Fast Track was defeated on the floor of the House twice in the 90s. We have been able to stop some stuff, but we do not yet have success in being able to put forward our alternatives. And here is the underlying challenge. And this is a kind of an academic point to this, but it's worth thinking about. How do you affect policy? This is the challenge we had to think about in the 90s when we suddenly realized the slow motion coup d'etat was underway. How do you affect, how do you effectively campaign on issues that a policymaking regime that to some degree is intentionally designed to be insulated from political accountability? I mean, the point here was to shift the decision-making away from those who would live with the results. They couldn't hold anyone accountable. The point here was to do it in a secretive process because sort of Dracula strategy, if any of this stuff went into the sunshine, it wasn't gonna go anyplace. So given that reality, then sort of the methodological challenge we faced, and we sort of created a new methodology for campaigning is we have political relevance as citizens in our home country. So there is no sort of international democracy per se. There can be forced transparency, but so the framework was to build cross-sectoral campaigns, coalitions, representing all the injured parties, and then internationally connected connecting them. Internationally connected country-based campaigns. Because we had to operate simultaneously locally, nationally and internationally. Locally to hold individual policymakers accountable, nationally to try and extract the right US position, and then internationally to try and affect the actual negotiations. And which stage of the process civil society constructed in this kind of methodology can affect is very specific to the type of political system in each country. So for instance, given the way the US executive branch's authority is, the way the fast track system works, the agencies, in charge, the advisory committees, we have a very limited ability to shape what the U.S. proposals will be, or if the U.S. starts negotiation. But during the negotiations, a lot of other countries actually have more of a capacity. And this gets to sort of the point you made about having odd partnerships where civil society in numerous countries can be on an issue in partnership with the developing country government against the U.S. government. So you had Doctors Without Borders, obviously an international NGO, but they're U.S. folks working very closely, as well as us as a consumer group, with negotiators in TPP from other countries who are fighting it out with the U.S. negotiators, who were doing pharma's work, and we were trying to help the other governments try and make sure that that was not actually, by pointing out, here's how the U.S. is going to screw you tomorrow. Look out for this thing, they did this 2 years ago. And that was our best value added, to try and empower those who were situated to try and, for all of civil society, avoid the worst happening. Once the agreement is done, if an agreement can be made, and sometimes it can't, the next question is, how do you stop it? And when it comes to the approval process, that's where the U.S. or governments that do not have parliamentary systems come in. So if you have a parliamentary form of government, your executive negotiator is your Congress. It's one block. Unless you can make a whole government fall, and that, you know, that almost happened in ACTA, so that's not doable. It can happen. That's what stopped ACTA in some countries. There is going to be a crisis of confidence vote. But unless you literally have done the civil society campaigning to force a government to fall, a parliamentary system, if you sign the thing, that's the same majority in the parliament. But in the U.S., it's different. So right now, we have this scenario in TPP, to make it practical, where despite announcing a framework agreement in 2011, the agreement wasn't actually signed, initialed, not signed until even later, but initialed, no deal was until October of 2015. That was because of the work of our international partners' domestic campaigns holding accountable their governments. Now the ball is basically passed to the U.S. civil society about the approval. The agreement can't go into effect unless both Japan and the U.S. implement it the way it's written. So now, to some degree, it's on us. But the international campaign meant it was delayed enough that it's now in our window of maximum accountability, which is the presidential campaign. So what we basically now have to do is, we have in our country, in the context of people having lived with the experience of the damage of agreements like NAFTA for 20 plus years, and academic research showing now those who are proponents of this model, increasingly the recent stuff David Autor has done, for instance, showing that their projections did not actually come to pass, but rather, yes, it's true, people's lived experience is real. It's been really bad for a lot of American workers, this model. Plus, there is the stark gap between the overpromises of incredible benefits and then the reality, which is even worse than the fact that, had they been honest about what the likely benefits were and it didn't work out, you had a lot of people who believed in this, the Democrats who voted for NAFTA, of which there are almost 100, amongst whom are some of the most dyed-in-the-wool TPP opponents, because they got screwed, as well as a large swath of their very pissed off constituents. So what are the big challenges now? If the public knows about TPP, they're against it. Polling shows that, it's very interesting. But right now, a very small percentage of the population knows the term TPP. It's been shut out of the mainstream media. If there was a $20 million advertising campaign where we could flood everyone with what it means, you would overnight change the polling. Because if you look at the polling, when you ask cold, what's TPP? More people know than they did 4 years ago, but it's still not great. But if you give them literally three sentences of the other side, your side, and some summary, opposition goes through the ceiling. So how do you get over the education? Part of it is people-to-people organizing, and part of it is using direct communications, the new open online ways of dealing with passing on information. But then what you have to overcome is these agreements put together all of the corporate interests united. So like with ACTA, it was the pharmaceutical industries and some other IP industries against civil society. But with the trade agreements, it's all of the interests. That said, at this moment, there is not a majority for TPP in the US Congress. And it's not just because some Republicans want more stuff. It is actually because there's been a huge shift in Republican no votes in their voting base and therefore their members. And so I want to recognize Stephanie Lowe, who's here, who's one of the members. Stephanie, raise your hand. Find her if you're from New York and you want to get involved, because she is one of the people leading the New York Fair Trade and Justice Coalition. In each US state, and if you're from someplace else, go to the map of Citizens Trade Campaign, click on your state, you'll find the contact. There's an organizer in each of the states. They know who the targets are. There are only a handful of them. We need to keep the majority against TPP in place, including through the lame duck Congress, which is the moment of least accountability. And by doing that, to close, the first step to turning around this agenda is to making sure there's no more of the same. Because this gets to serve the question, why is it so important to stop TPP? The only way we will ever get to fixing these rules or doing something new is when we can demonstrate to the powers now privileged in the system that their only choice is no deal or a new deal. If they think there can be more of the same, there will be no change. And that is how we can win. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Now, we have about 10 minutes for questions, and there are two microphones. So please come up to the microphones, ask your question for both or either speaker.
Thank you very much. My name is Nobuhiko Kusto, a former politician of Japan and representing a Japanese civil society organization opposing TPP for a long, long time. I have two questions. One question is that governance of the TPP system. As we referred, there are so many items involved, from human rights issue and environmental issues and currency issue as well. So that means the size and the degree of governance of the TPP as an organization will exceed the size of GATT, WTO, and some others. It's almost establishing a new United Nations for governing a new trade system of 21st century. So, is there anyone who is writing a design of such huge governance or not? So, this is my first question. The second question is this conference is superb, but there's a few people who refer to covert intention of TPP, which is liberalization of distribution system. So everybody who promotes TPP refers to a supply chain, value chain, et cetera, et cetera. So distribution modernization, so-called innovation, is a very important key part of this innovation of the TPP system. But distribution, if you change reformation distribution, will lead to reformation of society, which leads sometimes to destruction of society. So I think in case of, for example, United States and Korea Treaty, city of Seoul, the capital of Seoul, have to change more than 100 regulations and laws to comply with the US-Korea Treaty. So take into that situation into consideration, I would like to ask you some innovative reaction in the civil society, such as reaction of municipalities in the United States, local government in the United States, declaring a kind of TPP free zone or something like that, just like city of New York. And I'd like to ask how effective this can be. So if a local government can sue the government using a mechanism of ISDS, for instance, and can a local government can be really independent from the influence of the international convention. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like the comments from the panel, but I'm really addressing us. And that is the local organizers who have been working to defeat this trade agreement. We heard this morning that there isn't enough anger in the country to lead to a mass uprising. And I am questioning that to the extent that Donald Trump has liberated tremendous rage about the conditions that working people are facing. And Bernie Sanders has a more positive spin on it, but it's the same anguish that students are feeling about paying back loans, that we're feeling about what's happening with employment in the US. And I ask us whether we are going to have the courage to mobilize in mass actions with both sides enough to bring about some kind of resistance that will actually work to convince Congress, besides the lobbying that we've been doing. And the other thing I don't think we can omit from any of our discussions is the US military, and whether there's some way that the military threats of the tremendous armaments that are being produced and gifted in other parts of the world has something to do with intimidating people that and may impact on what happens in the economic realm, particularly around these agreements. So of course I'm interested in the responses of our esteemed, knowledgeable panelists, but I also throw out that for us to be talking about among ourselves.
Yes, yes. And I would just...
I'm sorry, we have literally 5 minutes. Is it all right if we allow them to answer the questions?
It's just a 30-second question.
Okay.
Is there a way for us in the creative community to turn our employer some of our employers against the agreement as it currently stands and not risk unemployment?
Thank you.
I think the questions are basic for you. It's the internal questions in the United States. The only thing that I would mention, and I think this is an important point, is the relation of the trade agreements or so-called trade agreements, intellectual property, or whatever they are included, investment, invested with state, dispute settlement, and their relation to other documents of international law. And I might say, in some respects, I may not agree with some of the things that I heard, because I think the United States, as any other country, should be respectful of international law as well, difficult as it may be sometimes to respect. What I think it's regrettable is that, to take just one example, because I don't want to be too long, in the question of TRIPS agreement, again, what can, let us say, a small country, it's being negotiated, and Brunei, sorry to mention Brunei, but I think it's the smallest country, but Brunei has a law that protects the possibility of compulsory license, probably not to produce, because they would not be able to produce, but to import medicaments. But they were forced to accept the TRIPS Plus clause in the TPP. What can they do? I don't know. I really don't know how enforceable this is. But in a question involving two states, a dispute, it could, of course, later on, invoke the International Court of Justice, but not at the time of the negotiation, because at the time of the negotiation, they say, well, you negotiate if you wish, but the reality is not that. You're forced to negotiate. That's the paradox. Even if you accept that other instruments, like the Human Rights Declaration, which is considered as common law nowadays, is being affected, a country would not dare to invoke it. So that's why I think also that in this respect of TRIPS flexibilities and other areas, you have to have coalitions of countries. That's what we did in the WTO, by the way, the G20 that someone mentioned, was created in order to have the possibility of facing the biggest powers. And we succeeded to some extent, at least in avoiding that it became worse. But I think it's really one of the problems that has not been solved. It's how you were able to enforce provisions that are in favor of developing countries, because they don't have what they can resort. They can avoid trade retaliation, maybe, but they would not be able to really enforce. And certainly, and I will make a final word, because since I came to from Brazil, I think this is important. It's the psychology about that you cannot live without these agreements. And I think in Brazil, for instance, nowadays there's a strong current, which probably will be in government, I don't know, a strong current say that Brazil isolated itself from the world because we are not part of the TPP and not part of the TTIP, although we are can't be part of certainly the TPP, we're not in the Pacific. But in any way, this kind of reasoning will finally lead smaller or even middle-sized or emerging countries to sign agreements that they know that are against their interest in some respects.
Yikes. To answer the questions, our longtime coalition partner from Japan, Suto-san, the scope of the TPP, who's writing the rules, unfortunately, a large part of that is being decided by industry advisors, and that is the democracy crisis. If it were just about commercial issues, it would not be good that just industry was involved, but it would not be as huge of a democracy crisis than the rewriting of the entire structure of policies and governance. The issue about TPP free zones, it's a great idea for organizing, and the AFL-CIO has organized a lot of resolutions in cities, city councils against TPP, and the mayors of New York, where we are, the mayor of LA, and many other mayors have spoken out against the TPP. However, the problem is the way the agreements are written, unless there's a specific exclusion that keeps out the agreement from binding at the local level, there's no way by having a TPP free zone that you literally, as a city or municipality, at least in US law, I don't know Japanese law, but in US law, you can't extract your way out. And the federal government has an obligation to enforce in all legal means. There's a GATT case like this called Beer 2, where they're told they have to sue, they have to preemptively litigate, they have to fine to force local compliance. There is no way to use ISDS, that is the irony. There are only rights for corporations and powers to sue. There are no obligations on the corporations, nor can a city or the federal government or an NGO sue the corporations. It is just one way. They get the rights, they get the right to enforce. As far as the New York activist who asked about harnessing the bipartisan trade rage, I think we have to really think about the moment we're at. Because when I was describing how we got here, it is because I want everyone to reflect on what it is. It is a uniquely auspicious moment to tank the TPP and TTIP and force the overdue discussion of what should replace these institutions. It's a necessary defense to get to an important offense. And in this moment, the question is how to harness that upset, because there in every state are a handful of Democrats and Republicans in the House of Representatives who practically are going to decide if we're going to have TPP or we're going to have turnaround. And how they all feel the heat that clearly is on a bipartisan basis is what's going to make the difference. And then finally, on the creative content industry question, I would recommend you connect with folks at Fight for the Future, which is a civil society group that works in that space that actually has been organizing explicitly employees of several of the high-tech firms that have come out for the TPP, despite the fact that sort of half their interests are not on that side and their employees are largely on the warpath.
Thank you. And thank you, all of you, for coming today, for listening, for hopefully taking notes and getting ready to participate in some action and capturing the moment. And we have to close because someone else needs a room. So those are realities that we deal with as well. And thank you for to all of our panelists, to all of our conveners, and to all of our student helpers who have tirelessly struggled behind the scenes. Oh, And we won't dismiss you entirely. We do have a reception, but we need to relocate to a different building. And again, wonderful student helpers will help you find the spot where there will be some libation, some food, some drinks, and for future conversations or more conversations. Sorry. So please do come to reception.